Welcome to Teaching Forward Now, a week-long summit series where I'm interviewing educators across the country and asking them my number one question: what do educators need to stop surviving and start thriving now? My name is Danielle Felton. I'm an elementary educator from the state of Maryland and author of Teach and Go Home, The Sophisticated Guide to Simplifying and Managing Your Workload and More. And today I get to travel internationally and ask my question to Mr. Marian Glavik. He is a Canadian resident, and he is also the author of two books that I want to mention. One is The Busy Educator's Guide to the World Wide Web, and the second is How to Succeed as an Elementary Teacher, the Most Effective Classroom Management Strategies for Teachers with Tough and Challenging Students. Good morning, Marian.
Good morning, Danielle. How are you?
I'm well. How are you today?
Good, good. It's nice sunny day. We can see green grass, so the snow has melted, and it's been just above freezing. So, which is really unusual for January up here in Canada. Usually it'll be around -15, -20 Fahrenheit, -30, -35 Celsius. So yeah, we've lucked out.
Well, I want to thank you for being here. I want to share a little bit with the audience about why it is such a big deal to have you here today. Marian Glavik was actually someone I came across his book first when I started writing my book, looking for just inspiration to know that this was actually a dream that I could pursue, and to see someone who had done it before me was an inspiration. It was a motivation to know that this was possible. And so now, years later, I actually reached out. You responded. I was shocked, and I had the opportunity to ask you my big question. So today I would like to ask you, what do educators need to stop surviving and start thriving now? What would you say?
Tough question. It really, really is a tough question. In fact, I co-wrote a book with Paul Jackson, a retired principal, and we answered this question. The book's called How to Thrive and Survive in Your Classroom, and it's available on Amazon, wherever books are sold as well. And the key to this is reflection. And Paul wrote 7 chapters detailing all the steps just on this concept. So I've got multiple instances where I use reflection in my 29-year teaching career. But I can give you two if you'd like.
Yes, please. What are your two biggest points on reflection?
Okay, the first one was. I can pinpoint it. It was my third year of teaching. I had been transferred from this wonderful school. My first assignment, and Danielle, it was a dream school. It was a rural school, nice new school, young staff. I made friends with all the staff members, the parents. All the kids were bussed in and out. They were farmers, rural, good working ethic. I mean, It was a dream, just a dream. And for a first year teacher, I was a French teacher. So I was teaching French to 4th, 5th, and 6th graders. And just the way the schedule worked out, I only had 2 lesson plans. So one day I would teach a 4th and 6th. The other day I would teach a 5th and 6th, but I always had the 6th every day. So it was a dream. It was a dream assignment. Unfortunately, because I was still on probation, I got bumped and I got transferred, and I got transferred to an inner city school. Tough school. It was a tough school. I was the French teacher for 7th graders. Mm-hmm. I taught French to 7 out of 8 classes. On the upside, it was only 1 lesson plan. So I really, really knew my curriculum. But it was a tough school. The teachers, very set in their ways. I'm this new teacher coming in, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed. They were, back then, and I'm not sure if the same in the United States, but back then, years ago, you could get a teaching degree after high school. All you needed was six weeks of teacher's college.
Wow.
So a lot of these teachers were what we had was called level D. And you know, they didn't have the knowledge I had. I was already in level A4. I was at the top of my level before I even started teaching, because I had a bachelor's degree and I also had a master's degree. But what I had in supposed this knowledge of progressive ideas, they had experience. One of the teachers, she taught 35 years, and 34 of her 35 years was in one classroom. Wow. in the same classroom as well. The teachers were now starting to teach children of their first students were coming in. And a lot of them, you know, grew up in it was a village at that time, only 15,000 people. So to give you an idea, every 12-year-old in that town had to go through my class because it was a middle school. It was a 7th and 8th. It was the only middle school in the entire district. So I knew every 12th grader, unless they'd gone to, you know, parochial or private school. So I'm the youngest person there. I'm the most inexperienced person there. I've got a chip on my shoulder thinking that I know it all. And I'm bringing all these, you know, new ideas. And it didn't take me long to find out that I was the weak link. So everything was on rotary. So students would move to class. They'd come into my class. Mm-hmm. And it hit me when the kids figured me out, because all the other teachers were so tight. They had their procedures in place. They really were strict. And here I am, you know, I'm pretty, you know, not loosey goosey, but I want to be friends with the students. I really want to promote my subject. I want to get to know them as students. And one incident, and it still burns in my mind. And this happened. This is almost 40 years ago. The bell would ring and they would take off out of that class, chairs flying, desks would be flying. And I'd spend the next 5 minutes putting all the desks and chairs back in place. And I didn't realize that it's the teacher that dismisses you, not the bell. Mm-hmm. And I didn't realize that. I wanted to be this nice teacher. So reflecting on it, I needed classroom management skills. That's the very first thing. And there was a course opening up in our district called Behavioral Exceptionalities. It was a half credit course. And this principal was a no nonsense principal. And he was excellent. And I finally figured out, you know, the basics of just basic classroom management, you know, how to get your routines in place, how to get your class set up, you know, what to do. And the next year it started getting better and better and better. So that was the one thing that really saved my career. Otherwise, I would have been turfed out. And unfortunately, there was a teacher across from me. I mean, he was very well organized. I got his lesson plans after he retired. Detailed lesson plans right down to the minute. Mm-hmm. But the kids, he had no classroom control. So he resigned. He was a bit, you know, pushed out in a way, but yeah, he resigned. The kids just torn to pieces. And I looked at him and I was next. I had got, you know, some basic classroom management skills. So to answer your question, for the first, you know, 5 to 8 years as a teacher, you really need to work on that, on your classroom management skills. And classroom management skills just isn't what happens in the classroom. It's, you know, who you are, you know, what your teaching philosophy is, what are your buttons? I mean, what buttons do the kids push to get you going? What are your weaknesses? What are your strengths? And then from there, you can go on to, you know, finding more about your students, getting, you know, procedures in place. One book that I recommend highly is a mentor of mine, Harry Wong. first days of school. I mean, he'll teach you all kinds of things about procedures. As soon as you mention, classroom procedures, I mean, that's Harry Wong. Harry, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful guy. Him and his wife, Rosemary. I had a chance to meet them out in California and have dinner with them at a wonderful Chinese restaurant. Very giving person. And I
want to ask you about when you said you realized immediately that you were the weakest link, but you started off coming in knowing confident, I'm at the top of the tier, I've got it going on. What was that point of reflection like? Was it just from looking at your peers and doing a comparison, or where did you really find the internalization of, I got to figure this out. This is not going to work.
Well, one thing as a beginning teacher, you're trying to find your style. Mm-hmm. And, I would look at my very first school. I was going into every class. So I found out that, the best teachers in the school. And I would go to a class and the kids were all ready for me and they're wonderful, da, da, da. And after, teaching my French after 35, 40 minutes, I mean, the class is almost in a shambles, not quite. And the teacher would have to come in and reorganize them. And I always wondered, how do you do it? Are you a strict teacher? Do you, at that time, number of teachers would yell at their students. So I tried to do that. And I found out, I can't be that teacher without that spine. Well, with a spine, but I wanted to be flexible, but I didn't know how to be flexible. So I started taking the best from all these teachers, and it took me a long time to figure out what's your style. What is your style? I mean, are you a very strict teacher? Will you let some things go? Are you into procedures, and routines? Are you more subject-based? Are you more student-centered? So again, your philosophy. So I had a lot to work out. So thinking that, after three teaching blocks in teachers college, thinking that you know it all, you don't know it all. So it's a work in progress. So you really need to know your teaching style, what you're comfortable with. And you are comparing yourself, and that's the big thing with teachers. I found that we don't want to make mistakes, but as well, we don't want to acknowledge weakness. Mm-hmm. And I used to have these conversations with my principal. I said, I think we need to tell parents out there that we can't do it all. That we really do need, we need help. We need help from parents. We need help from the community. And he said, that was the persona. It was, no, we can do it all. And as a teacher, I found out I couldn't do it all. I needed to reach out to other teachers. I needed someone that I could talk to and say, look, this isn't working out. And I had one teacher on staff where we worked out a deal. I would have, I had tough kids, especially back then we had self-contained special ed classes, and these kids were tough. I mean, I had one class out of 15 kids, 14 were on special education plans, and they were tough. So I would have one student who would just wreck my class completely, and I would just have a little note I would write to my friend, please keep him for the next half hour. I owe you. And I give it to this kid. I say, can you go up to Mr. So-and-so's class and just deliver this to him? And he'd sit in that class, right, for the next half hour, an hour, and he'd have a great time. I'd have a breather. My kids would have a breather. And that's what you need to do. You need these little tips and tricks,
You definitely need a good teacher friend, someone to keep sane, someone to converse with, and just to make sure that you're not insane, that you are doing things.
No, I remember taking this one course, and it was dealing with real, really tough kids. We're talking violence, and this was a course where you're shown how to put hands on. I mean, very, very not controversial, but. But there are cases where, before you call in the police, you need to be able to deal with these kids. And these two teachers, oh, they were a hoot. They had a lot of experience, and they would joke about, you know, when the kid would throw up on them or spit on them, they would have a bet whether or not it went left or right. And then they would bet copies. And that's what you need to do. You need to have that debrief and you need to laugh about it. And I think the one thing I took away after many, many years is don't take it personally. Uh-huh. I mean, it's not about you. You're that person in the class. You're that authoritative figure. And sometimes kids feel really, really comfortable in your class that they do. They let go because you're a safe person and the class is a safe place. And sometimes that's what they need. Otherwise, you know, if they do it at home, unfortunately, some of them get beat up and, you know.
That's a very good point about the safety, establishing that safety. That's so important for the students to be able to present themselves as well in a more comfortable and enjoy their learning experiences.
That's right.
What was your second point?
Well, the second point was after about 8-10 years of teaching, I was burnt out. I didn't have anything more to give. I was really tired. I seriously thought about leaving the profession. I was looking at other avenues, and I wasn't making a change. I wasn't making a difference. It was depressing. I was beat. So again, sat down, you know, reflected on things. And the one thing that started to happen at that time, this was 92, 93, is something called the internet started happening. And I was always in the computers, even my first year, but it was a computer that wasn't connected to anything. So it would do, you know, it would do these word games and things like that. You know, it was a lot of fun, but you couldn't really do much with it with one or two computers or even a lab. But when the internet came out and you could plug that in and you're connected to this world wide web, it was phenomenal. Now I had a leg up because my wife was a computer programmer at the time. And she was dealing with all these internet protocols. She knew about FTP, file transfer protocol. She was dealing with Telnet. She knew how to do all those other bizarre words like Archie and Jughead and IRC chat. I mean, and I got into the Usenet groups and all that stuff. So I was a bit ahead of the curve, and I got my first email address in 92, 93, found other like-minded people, and we formed a really tight group. And that really stimulated me because it just opened up this incredible possibilities. I mean, I could connect my kids with kids from anywhere in the world. Mm-hmm. I could have my kids doing projects with kids down in San Antonio and tell them about things like we do up here, like tobogganing in the wintertime. And they would, you know, tell us about not having snow in 2 or 3 years, right? And we could do projects together. And then we could go to Europe. We could go to Japan. I mean, we did all kinds of great stuff. And it really gave me the boost. Professionally, because of the way the internet worked back then, it was all text-based. So we'd have this forum called the Electronic Village, and I'd be talking to teachers. I wouldn't know who they were. So it cut across all kinds of lines. For example, back then, elementary teachers just didn't talk to high school teachers. Heaven forbid that an elementary teacher talked to a principal of a high school. It just didn't happen. But because I just know you as Daniela, I don't know you're a principal. And I'm an elementary teacher, and I'm talking to you about a concept. And it just broke down all these barriers. And it broke down barriers between parochial schools and high school teachers and elementary, and even between, you know, French teachers and language arts teachers and science teachers. I mean, that part was great. And then the other part was, it was something new. It was the shiny new thing. And I got a lot of publicity. I was the go-to person in the board with a team of others. And you know, we started getting speaking gigs. I'd go off to the US to do some speaking engagements. I do speaking engagements here across Canada. It was the impetus to my very first book, which is way out of date now, you know, the Busy Educator's Guide to the World Wide Web, because there was no Google back then. I mean, there was no place where you could find, you know, you could find teacher sites. So, you know, I wrote a book and I cataloged every teacher site I could find. So teachers could just say, okay, I wanted this, you know, science site, where do I go? Da, da, da. Or I do this, da, da, da. So it did very well. And it just, you know, it gave me that boost I needed, you know, to last for the next, you know, 20 years of my career. And so, you know, going back, you're reflecting, you know, and again, for your audience, other teachers, after about your eighth, ninth, 10th year, mm-hmm. start looking at a project outside of yourself, you know, like the project that you're doing right now. You know, it could be, you know, in your classroom, you know, you might be the specialist on STEAM and STEM, or you might do something with 3D printing, or you might do outreach with your parents. You might be the person that takes care of, you know, a breakfast program or a program for minorities. Or you might want to go into administration. You know, you might want to become a consultant for your area. It might be math, it might be science, it might be language arts. It might be a vice principalship, a principalship, or even superintendency, director. Absolutely. Or my route was I debated whether or not to become a speaker or an author. And one speaker said, you know, you have to decide, do you want to be a speaker or a writer? And I, you know, decided to become, you know, the writer, and, you know, do the website and do the books. So, you know, that's what I think will propel you past those first 10 years into your 20th and your 30th year. And then by the time you get there, and, you know, as you probably know from your administrative courses, is you come up with an exit plan for exiting teaching. I mean, what are you going to do in your retirement? I mean, now that I'm at that age, and I retired early. I retired at 54. This is my 10th year of retirement. And I hopefully I've got another, you know, 20, 30 years left in me. But, you know, what do you do after teaching? Do you continue? Do you become a mentor to teachers, or do you find something else? And I think it all comes back to reflection. You really do have to sit down with yourself, with a mentor. You do need a formal system. In our book, you know, How to Thrive and Survive, Paul really goes through in detail what questions to ask, what questions to answer, what people to ask, you know, setting up that network, mm-hmm. of people, and sitting down and really thinking, you know, what do I want? Do I still want to stay as a teacher? If I am staying as a teacher, what's the next step? What's my plan? And you do have to plan these out, and you have to be brutally honest with yourself. You know, as I'm sure you have been, and I've been as well. I found out that I couldn't be a principal. I mean, I'm just such a perfectionist that I would just go nuts with all the things going on in the school. So, you know, sometimes, you know, it's the brutality of the truth that, you know, someone says, Marian, you know, you may want to take, you know, this path. And you know what? That's okay. Mm-hmm. That's okay.
And some of my communities we talk about that being a self-inventory, and taking that inventory of yourself to make sure,
yes.
find out. You have to do those check-ins constantly. You should do them often. Who you are today could be completely different in 6 months based on your experiences and your interests. Yeah. I have to say that you promised me two answers, but I heard community, I heard reflection, I heard the significance of a good laugh, I heard the positivity of having a passion. We have to establish our own passions to keep us going. I love that touch on burnout because it is real. It's something that it could be real. Someone's survival story. It's been a part of my survival story. So just to say that we have to be in charge of our own passions as well. I want to say thank you, but before I let you go, and before we leave this interview, I want to let everyone know that Marian has offered a downloadable gift. So please, please, please check that out on his speaker page, which will come after this email. And I would like to say thank you so much for taking the time to speak with me, allowing me just to take in this information. I thought it was so interesting is how your experiences is from the 90s. But they're relatable to today as far as just the outreach and our collaborative efforts. We have so many opportunities. And I can say that with the internet, with Google, I haven't seized them all in my class. And so you have just reignited me to think bigger, even bigger than before. So to everyone, thank you so much for watching. Thank you, Marian.
Well, thank you, Danielle. Thank you, teachers, for tuning in. We really appreciate it.
Absolutely. If you'd like to carry the conversation forward, you're welcome to join us in our Facebook group, Teaching Forward Now Summit 2021. And I wish you all a phenomenal day, and I'll see you in the next interview.